Most of us are familiar with blockchain technology and how it's a transparent digital ledger that records transactions. In the early days, most of the transactions that took place on the blockchain were explicitly financial. It was trading one cryptocurrency for another. But because they were visible and because they're recorded on this blockchain, what was often not acknowledged is that they were inherently social. And as the technology started to develop, we began to see more and more use cases that were more explicitly social. So new token standards started to develop, like non-fungible tokens, and we started seeing use cases like NFTs appearing in PFPs, and NFTs became a much bigger social flex and a tool for social capital. We're now at the stage in Web3 where we're seeing more complex examples of social interaction. We're starting to see DAOs develop and social graphs, and this is what Rarify Labs is really interested in, is how do we facilitate this social exchange and how do we make it interoperable and multi-chain.
I'm Lasha Antadze, co-founder at Rarify.
I'm Kitty Horlick, I'm the communication director at Rarify Labs.
For me, it seems like back to the future in literal terms, because we kind of like going back at the start of the internet and social interactions and saying that, wait, we kind of missed out an ingredient called the user ownership or privacy or the ability to own and control my social graph.
So one of the biggest issues that we see within Web2 socials is that you don't actually own your following. It belongs to the platform, and if they want to, they can shut down your account and you lose your followers, you possibly lose your livelihood. You don't have any ownership over that social capital. It's siloed and it's trapped inside that platform. One of the things that Web3 does is it gives you the opportunity to move your following across platforms, and you're free to entertain them wherever you wish. As Web3 evolves, we want to prevent it from replicating the dynamics of Web2. And we don't want Web3 users to find themselves or their identities trapped on one specific blockchain or one specific ecosystem. And this is why an identity protocol that caters to the decentralized social layer is so vital.
Not to fall in the pitfalls of the Web2, the interoperability is a very important aspect of the on-chain identities or the user reputations that gets built across the different ecosystems. So social graph is like a data map that shows the interactions and dependencies between those interactions, and that could be used to provide relevant suggestions from a content perspective or from like friendship perspective or my interests or belongings, or even predict some parts of my desires and willingness to purchase or become part of the stuff. To build those social graphs in a decentralized network, we need to keep recording and somehow collecting the different parts and components of the social graph. And in decentralized networks, those components are marked and recorded by issuance and ownership of NFTs, non-transferable tokens, and different token standards. And this string of tokens with their history is what builds up the social graph. In contrast to the previous fungible tokens, which could be like easily swapped and value exchanged, so reputation and identity is a hard thing to replicate and take from one place to another.
And there's an additional challenge with identity components, because all of the metadata and all of the detail that makes it non-fungible has to be transferred too. Whereas with the fungible token, like a currency, you just need that currency. There's nothing extra that you're sending with it. Rarimo is able to support the transition of that additional data.
To capture more complex interactions between the users, we're using different token standards like NFTs, so-called soulbound tokens. That could be like minted, issued, and only belongs to you. So it's not something you can transfer from one person to another. So it's intrinsically yours. Those tokens are used to keep the record keeping of every action we do between the users on chain and across different applications. As an example, if I follow someone or mirror their content or even like the post that they're providing in social feed, all those interactions are captured by minting tokens that are attached to a user wallet. And then this entire string of issued tokens is what forms a decentralized social graph. But the biggest difference between the social graph of Web3 and the Web2 identities is that those tokens and this wallet belongs to me. So I, me as a user, can choose which parts of the identifiers and the tokens I want to display and provide for the end application, while in contrast to Web2, I'm just an object in for the application and my data is tradable without me even knowing about it. And this is the fundamental difference, both from an infrastructure, incentive, and architectural perspective. Not architectural, but
a social perspective.
But social perspective as well. And this is what differentiates Web3 from Web2. Rarimo is an interoperability protocol, runs across different chains. That means that we have smart contract deployed for all connected chains and enabling developers to integrate with us just once, but being able to communicate and exchange value and data across chains in seamless and easiest way possible. What differentiates us being focused on the social layer of blockchain means we are keeping the state and metadata on our side and making retrievable to the applications on the other side in the easiest and cost-effective way. Going forward, the using of ZK proofs as part of the keeping the privacy of the data or user identity that's being shared across the ecosystems is something we support. And for the credentials or identifiers issued as SBTs or NFTs or dynamic NFTs, it's super important to replicate and update the state in the most cost-effective way across the chains. And Rarimo enabling to bundle these different state updates and push together across different chains is what makes it cost-effective and easily manageable for the identity issuers.
So I first became interested in interoperability once I realized that technical trade-offs meant that no single blockchain or even one single ecosystem could ever provide all of the infrastructure that you need for a healthy and rich Web3. Web3, like from the bottom up, is built on an entirely different value system, and the actual infrastructure needs to reflect that as well. And we can't just migrate the tech stacks over from Web2, and we can't just migrate the ways of doing things over from Web2. There has to be like a ground up reinvention of what's happening, like a great deal of innovation, including around interoperability.